Hello friends, welcome to another episode by Engineering Today, and we're back with some latest space updates. First of all, we'll take a look at the 29 Raptor engines installed on Super Heavy within 14 hours following a boost to SpaceX's Orbital launch program. And at the end, we'll talk about Bezos' failure to impress GAO and facing defeat in the Artemis lander contract protest. As a result, the contract now steps with SpaceX again. Before we dig into the details, we're excited to let you know that we've launched our new channel, Defense Today, to cater your latest updates about U.S. defense programs and some global movements as well. Check the link description below to give it a look and please subscribe. Now, let's take a look at our first update regarding SpaceX rapidly installing Raptor engines in the giant Super Heavy. SpaceX achieved another milestone feat within a night. SpaceX was already gearing up their production and testing procedure to carry out the orbital launch as soon as possible. Now it reached a further speed by installing scores of engines in a small duration of time. On August 1st, Starbase got a delivery of 5 new Raptor engines straight from the Raptor factory. By the evening at nearly 6 p.m. Central Daylight Time, SpaceX rolled out one of the Raptor engines for installing it in Booster 4. Following this chain, several Raptors were rolled out. By the 2nd of August morning, 6 a.m. Central Daylight Time, according to some reports, SpaceX had installed 27 engines on the Super Heavy. By the next 2 hours, SpaceX installed the remaining 2 Raptor engines, remarkably completing the installation of 29 next-gen Raptor engines within just more than half a day. On the 2nd of August 2021, Elon Musk tweeted, "Installing Starship booster engines for first orbital flight." He also shared a photo of Super Heavy with Raptors. The tweet reads, "Raptors on Super Heavy." On the 3rd of August, SpaceX tweeted, "29 Raptor engines and 4 grid fins have been installed on Super Heavy ahead of our first orbital flight." On the 1st of August, SpaceX also installed all the 4 grid fins on the Super Heavy Booster 4. SpaceX teams also painted the fins in a black color. Regarding the grid fin installation and its design, Musk tweeted, "Indeed, grid fin designs clearly work, but do they maximize payload? Good chance that they do not. Something with much more drag to reduce terminal velocity, and so reduce landing propellant, might have better performance. Not sure. Potential future optimization." From Musk's comment, "potential future optimization," it's quite plausible that there may be changes in design or structure of the fins in the future, depending on the performance it shows in the upcoming orbital flight. One thing worth noting in Super Heavy grid fins is that it's much different in comparison to Falcon booster fins, not only in size but also working. As some reports say, Super Heavy grid fins will be extended throughout the orbital launch mission, whereas those fins on Falcon boosters are deployed after only the first stage gets separated from the upper stage. Along with the assembly work of Super Heavy booster, SpaceX has done a lot of work with other parts of this orbital mission. SpaceX has already lifted off and installed the orbital launch table atop the launch mount. Works on it are still continuing for perfect performance. SpaceX has also done a good development with the Starship prototype SN20. Recently, it was noticed that SpaceX teams are installing heat shield tiles on the SN20 nose cone. SN20 is now ready for receiving the aft fins needed for aerodynamic control of the vehicle. Regarding the orbital launch tower, Musk tweeted, "Stage 0, which is everything needed to launch and catch the rocket, is at least as hard as the booster or ship." Keeping an eye on the developments of the speeding Starbase, Musk tweeted, "Starbase is moving at warp 9. According to recent updates, SpaceX teams have rolled out the Super Heavy Booster 4 on the 3rd of August. In the meantime, SN20 moved from mid-bay to high bay. Some reports say that SpaceX may not first transport the booster to the launch table, as installation and checking works are ongoing there. Instead, the booster might be sent to one of the suborbital pads earlier used for Starship launch tests. After completing initial cryoproof and engine tests, it's expected that Booster 4 will then heat towards the orbital launch site, followed by a 29-engine static fire test. Then, if all is well, SpaceX may move for orbital flight. SpaceX's recent rapidity of installing 29 Raptor engines on Booster 4 within more than half a day has greatly surpassed the earlier record of installing 30 NK-15 engines on Soviet Union's moon-bound rocket N-1 within just 2 days. Though the Soviet N-1 rocket was a failed venture and didn't succeed ever, its engine installation time was still a record. N-1 also comprised the most powerful first-stage booster ever built before Super Heavy. If it was successful, it would have been able to surpass the Saturn V rocket in thrust impulse. What took the Soviets 48 hours to install engines at that time, SpaceX has taken only a mere 12 to 14 hours to install nearly the same number of engines. As the present record of SpaceX has beat the Soviet record on installation time, in terms of thrust power, SpaceX's Super Heavy excels far more than N-1. While N-1 with 30 engines had produced nearly 4,630 tons thrust in ground static fire, Super Heavy, on the other hand, can produce more than 5,400 tons of thrust, beating by a great deal. Some reports say that sections for Booster 5 and Ship 21 are already in view in the Starbase, giving us a hope of another orbital flight after the upcoming one. Work on a Pathfinder nose cone with a large space open for payload bay doors is seen in recent days. According to Musk, this new form of nose cone will enable Starships to start their operational flights in the future. It's expected that SpaceX will use their initial operational Starship flights for launching their own Starlink satellites. With time, SpaceX will continue to focus on spare nose cones for developing much efficient designs. Elon Musk also stated about the down-mass capability of Starship, with future possibility of using Starship to grab out Hubble from orbit after it stops operating, and showcase it for space lovers to see. Taking a look at our last update, we'll see GAO rejects Blue Origin and Dynetics protests for NASA's Artemis lander provider selection. Since NASA has selected SpaceX only for the contract of building Artemis lunar lander in April 2021, a series of legal proceedings has been chained down owing to the protests filed by Blue Origin and Dynetics to the Government Accountability Office, GAO. On the 30th of July, the agency rejected Blue Origin's and Dynetics' protests to stop the lander contract that SpaceX got. The agency rejected Blue Origin's protests on the ground that Blue Origin expresses no views as to the merits. The agency further said NASA did not violate procurement law. According to NASA, the cost of SpaceX's bid was about half that of Dynetics and one-fourth the amount received by Blue Origin. NASA had also been impressed by Starship's innovative design and future-looking technology that might also one day be used on Mars. To NASA, Blue Origin's proposal was the second cheapest option, and it was nearly asked for more than $6 billion. According to Kathy Luters, NASA Associate Administrator, the space agency has little funding left after they granted SpaceX $2.94 billion award. She had also said that it would be a waste of time to even think about Blue Origin's $6 billion contract. The Government Accountability Office stated NASA made award to SpaceX for a total evaluated price of $2,941,394,557. After noting that SpaceX submitted the lowest price proposal with the highest rating and that the offers submitted by Blue Origin and Dynetics were significantly higher in price, NASA also concluded that the agency lacked the necessary funding to make more than one award. The watchdog agency further stated, NASA's announcement provided that the number of awards the agency would make was subject to the amount of funding available for the program. In addition, the announcement reserved the right to make multiple awards, a single award, or no award at all. In reaching its award decision, NASA concluded that it only had sufficient funding for one contract award. GAO further concluded there was no requirement for NASA to engage in discussions, amend or cancel the announcement as a result of the amount of funding available for the program. As a result, GAO denied the protest arguments that NASA acted improperly in making a single award to SpaceX. It's good news that the Government Accountability Office has given their decision within their specified time period. NASA said that for the GAO only, an uncrewed flight of Artemis 1 is on track for this year, and a crewed Artemis 2 mission is planned for 2023. That's all for today, and oh yes, please don't forget to visit our new channel, Defense Today. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.